Good morning and good afternoon. I hope we can be back in Sunday school soon. I hope you're all doing okay. I hope that this time will brighten your day. So let's talk about Jesus and all that he did.
Stuck inside, Oceanside kids.
Hi, kids. We learn from the Bible that Jesus is so loving and so powerful. The Bible talks about how Jesus met people who were blind. He chose to heal them, and their lives were changed. Jesus was around people who were sick, and he chose to heal them, and their lives were changed. Jesus has the power to stop people from dying. But Jesus is also loving and powerful enough to heal people who have already died. Today, we're going to talk about a time when Jesus healed someone who had already died. There was a man named Lazarus. Isn't that a crazy name? Can you try saying Lazarus? Go ahead. Wow, that was pretty good. Lazarus got very, very sick. And he was a close friend of Jesus. When he got sick, his sister sent a message to Jesus to let him know that Lazarus was sick. Lazarus' sisters, Mary and Martha, knew that Jesus was powerful enough to heal their brother, so they cried out to him for help.
Jesus, please help our brother Lazarus. He is sick.
But by the time Jesus got to Lazarus' town, Lazarus had already died. The Bible tells us that Jesus was so sad that he cried. Lazarus' family thought that his death was the end of the story, but Jesus knew that it was not the end. Lazarus' family took Jesus to the tomb where they had put Lazarus' body after he died. When Jesus got to the tomb, he said, "Open it up." He called into the tomb and said, "Lazarus, come out." And Lazarus rose from the dead, stood up, and walked out of the tomb alive.
Hey guys, I'm alive!
Everyone who was there was amazed and filled with joy after seeing the power of God.
Yay!
Everyone who was there was amazed at what they had seen, and they believed in Jesus. Before Jesus healed Lazarus, he told his sisters that anyone who believes in him will live forever, even if they die. What did Jesus mean by that? He meant that if we believe in Jesus, when we die, that is not the end of our story. We will go to heaven and live with God the Father forever. To help us remember that we can live even after we die, I have a memory verse to share with you guys. John chapter 11, verse 25 says, "I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live, even though they die." Could you guys repeat that after me? I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live even though they die. John chapter 11, verse 25. Awesome. Thanks so much for listening. We love you and we are praying that you have a wonderful week. Bye. Hi, kids. Today we're going to sing a song called Big House.
Sorry. Okay. Now do it.
Hi, kids. Today we're going to sing a song called Big House. It's about heaven and how when God brings us there to be with... Hi, kids. Today we're going to sing a song called Big House. It's about heaven and how when God brings us there to be with him, it's going to be so great. We did the actions together as a family, so maybe if you want to gather the people in your home to dance with you, that'd be great. So get up and get ready to move.
Okay. Beside me. Yeah, that's how you're To have you with us this morning. I'm going to sing a song called Amazing Grace, and I just invite you to sing along.
How precious been unending love. Amazing grace. The Lord has
I'm going to talk to God out in nature right now, and I'm inviting you to join me. Well, Lord, it's strange to be apart, and here I am talking to you, and I'm in your beautiful creation. And I know that your church is scattered, but we are yet together in spirit and having to really perhaps preach the gospel to ourselves today, that your Holy Spirit is present with us. From South Korea to New Zealand to Europe to Canada to Africa, all across the globe, you are present with us. So, Lord, help us to remember that this morning. Help us to feel your presence, to know that you are a good God. Even though we're apart right now, Lord, we want to together listen to you, to hear your words speak to us, to make room for you, Jesus, to allow you to look at us. And hear what you may say to us this morning. Pray for those who are suffering today. Jesus, would you come and meet them? We pray for those who are sick and ill, that you would heal. We pray for wisdom for our governments. Give us the grace to follow our governments as they seek our best and our good. We pray for our healthcare workers. We pray for the elderly, and especially elderly grandparents who many of us have and worry about. We pray that you would meet us in our mental health, in our physical health, our emotional health, our relationships, in the quiet places of our heart that nobody else knows about but you. We thank you that you are with us through Jesus and by your Spirit, Father. Would you glorify yourself through us? Let us know your presence, for in your presence there is fullness of joy. Amen.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to Oceanside Community Church Online. My name is Christiana, and we are excited to be worshiping with you this morning. If you're new to us, you can find more about us on our website at www.oceansidecommunitychurch.ca. We'd love to connect with you, so please do get in touch with us through any of our social media platforms or by filling out a connection card on our website or in the video description. Speaking of connecting with us, we'd love for you to join our weekly lobby time, Sundays at 9:45 a.m. on Facebook Live. This upcoming week is also our Missions Week, so please do join our Global Workers, McAllisters, on Facebook Live at 11 a.m. on Wednesday morning for our midweek devotional. We do so appreciate your continued support during this season. If you'd like to give, you can do so either by mail, on our mobile app, online through our website, or by e-transfer. We're so happy that you're with us this morning and hope that you enjoy the service. Take care, Oceanside.
Hey everyone, good morning. My name is Chris. I'm going to be sharing with you the scripture reading for this morning, which is from the Gospel of John, chapter 11. I'm going to be reading verses 1 to 4, 17 to 26, 38 to 48. So starting in verse 1. Now a man named Lazarus was sick. He was from Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. This Mary, whose brother Lazarus now lay sick, was the same one who poured perfume on the Lord and wiped his feet with her hair. So the sisters sent word to Jesus, "Lord, the one you love is sick." When he heard this, Jesus said, "This sickness will not end in death. No, it is for God's glory, so that God's Son may be glorified through it." Jumping to verse 17. On his arrival, Jesus found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Now Bethany was less than 2 miles from Jerusalem, and many Jews had come to Martha and Mary to comfort them in the loss of their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went out to meet him, but Mary stayed at home. "Lord," Martha said to Jesus, "if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But I know that even now, God will give you whatever you ask." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." Martha answered, "I know that he will rise in the resurrection at the last day." Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live, even though they may die. Even though they die. And whoever lives by believing in me will never die. Do you believe this?" And verse 38. Jesus, once more deeply moved, came to the tomb. It was a cave with a stone laid across the entrance. "Take away the stone," he said. "But Lord," said Martha, the sister of the dead man, "by this time there is a bad odor, for he has been there 4 days." Then Jesus said, "Did I not tell you that if you believe, you will see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone. Then Jesus looked up and said, "Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I know that you always hear me. But I said this for the benefit of the people standing here, that they may believe that you sent me." When he had said this, Jesus called out in a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out." The dead man came out, his hands and feet wrapped with strips of linen and a cloth around his face. Jesus said to them, "Take off the grave clothes and let him go." Therefore, many of the Jews who had come to visit Mary and had seen what Jesus did believed in him. But some of them went to the Pharisees and told them what Jesus had done. Then the chief priests and the Pharisees called a meeting of the Sanhedrin. "What are we accomplishing?" they asked. "Here is this man performing many signs. If we let him go on like this, everyone will believe in him, and the Romans will come and take away both our temple and our nation." Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we pray that you will open our hearts and our minds to what it is that you want to say to us today. Please bless the reading of your word. Amen.
Well, good morning, Oceanside Community Church. It's so good to be with you this morning. I am here on the banks of the Englishman River, along some trails, and you might be able to hear the rushing of the river water. Hopefully it's soothing you, not to sleep, just soothing your soul, hopefully, but keep your attention on the Word of God this morning. I'm here for a specific reason, because we're talking about the story of Lazarus being raised from the dead. And if you know the story, he was in a tomb, which in that day would have been carved out of a rock, and a stone would have been rolled in front of it. So it could have been something like this. In fact, we know that it might have been in a garden, for when Jesus was buried in Joseph of Arimathea's tomb, it says it was in a garden. And they would have rolled, kind of carved this out a little more and rolled a stone in front of it, and that would have been the tomb. So hopefully this helps bring some imagery of what's happening this morning, that they would have been gathered around in a place like this. And when Jesus said, "Take away the stone," they would have rolled it away and they would have seen Lazarus come out of probably a deeper tomb than this. But I'm here with some of my friends. This is my little snail right here, who's hanging out with me, and who knows what else might jump out at me as I'm talking. Well, believe it or not, this is our last message in this Gospel of John series for now. And I say for now because, of course, back in 2016, we did chapters 1 through 6 in our Eat, Drink, and Live series. And now here in 2020, we've done chapters 7 through 11 in this series, Confused Over Christ. And this chapter 11, kind of moving into chapter 12, is a key turning point in the book of John. In the next chapter, chapter 12, Jesus will be anointed for his burial by Mary, Lazarus' sister, and she will pour nard on his feet and wipe it with her hair and all that. And then later in chapter 12, Jesus will make his triumphant entry into Jerusalem, what we know as Palm Sunday. And really from that point on, it's all about Jesus' death and his last moments with his disciples and moving toward that moment. So here in chapter 11, it's key because this is really Jesus' last public miracle and last public talking and teaching he does. And so it's a great place to end before we pick it up sometime, 2023, who knows when, in chapter 12. So this is really Jesus' last sign that he makes. And so it's significant that he chooses the raising of Lazarus from the dead as the last sign in the book of John before his own death and resurrection. A few weeks ago, you would have heard Thomas say in our Facebook lobby fellowship time on Facebook Live, 9:45 a.m. every Sunday, be there, how he was watching this documentary series, The Last Dance, and it's about the Chicago Bulls and their run of titles, but really about their sixth and final title, The Last Dance, the last time they were together. And I've started watching it myself, and I'm enjoying it. Just brings back lots of memories and nostalgia for I was a teenager in the mid-90s and loved basketball, and so that was really kind of my era for that. But so this is really Jesus' last dance, so to speak. It's his last sign that he makes, and it's very intentional and specific what he does here and what John does as the author. Not only is this Jesus' seventh and final sign, but it's also one of his I am sayings, which there's seven of also in the book of John. And so that's included here in chapter 11. And really this whole chapter of Jesus raising Lazarus from the dead ultimately is all about John's invitation for salvation, for belief in Jesus. So those are the three things I want to talk about this morning: a sign, a saying, and salvation. So we're going to look at each of these in chapter 11. So let's start with this significant and important sign. And Jesus gives us a preview or a precursor in the beginning of the chapter that he's going to use this as a sign for God's glory. So chapter 11 verses 1 through 4 under point number 1 here of the sign. Now a man named Lazarus was sick. He was from Bethany, the village of Mary and his sister Martha. This Mary, whose brother was Lazarus, now lay sick, was the same one who poured perfume on the Lord and wiped his feet with her hair. And you can read that in chapter 12. So the sister sent to Jesus, "Lord, the one you love is sick." When he heard this, Jesus said, "This sickness will not end in death. No, it is for God's glory, so that God's Son may be glorified through it." So Jesus tells us, I'm going to use this moment as a chance to bring glory to God and to myself and to show you who I really am. And he's going to tell us that in the saying part later in chapter 11. So this entire chapters 2 through 11 is often referred to as the book of signs. And there are seven signs in John in chapters 2 through 11. And so this is the last and final sign, and everything kind of comes full circle in this final sign that Jesus is saying, everything that I've done up until now, the other six signs, they're all pointing towards this greater sign, which then points toward the ultimate sign, which is Jesus' own resurrection. So throughout the book of John, Jesus has been showing himself as the fulfillment of the Old Testament, particularly the story of the Exodus, the most important story in the Old Testament. And so Jesus has been showing that he is the leader of a new Exodus, that he is the one greater than Moses. In fact, John tells us in chapter 1, verse 17, that the law came through Moses, but grace and truth come through Jesus Christ. And so Jesus has been showing this in really interesting ways. So for example, whereas in the signs of the plagues that led to Israel's deliverance, God through Moses turns the water in the river into blood, and there's wailing throughout Egypt. But Jesus, in his first sign in chapter 2 of John, what does he do? He turns water into wine, and there's joy and celebration. So Jesus is showing, hey, I'm doing something new, something different. Moses leads the Israelites through the Red Sea by parting the waters, and they walk through on dry land. But Jesus kind of tops that by walking on top of water on the Sea of Galilee and then leading the disciples safely to the other side. He's reenacting the Exodus miracle, showing I'm the fulfillment of this. And then we get the final sign before deliverance for the Israelites in Exodus is the destroying of life, the killing of the firstborn throughout all of Egypt. But the final sign Jesus gives before his deliverance of rising from the dead is the restoring of life, the raising of Lazarus from the dead. So you see what Jesus is doing. He's saying, I'm leading a different, a new exodus, not just from an oppressive nation into a new land, but an exodus out of slavery to sin and out of death and into resurrection and life, something new, something different. And so Jesus is going to summarize or follow up this sign that he does with Lazarus by giving us a saying, and perhaps his most important saying in the book of John. So let's look at point two, this saying of Jesus in chapter 11. So verses 17 through 26. It says, on his arrival, Jesus found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Now Bethany was less than 2 miles from Jerusalem, and many Jews who had come to Martha and Mary to comfort them in the loss of their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went out to meet him, but Mary stayed at home. Lord, Martha said to Jesus, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But I know that even now God will give you whatever you ask. And Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. And Martha answered, well, I know he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day. But Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live even though they die. And whoever lives by believing in me will never die. Do you believe this? And she replies, yes, Lord. So this is Jesus' fifth sign out of his 7 signs, and it's perhaps his most powerful. And it represents this deep and intimate bond and union that we are called to with Jesus, that our only hope is Jesus, that we should cling to him. Why? Because he says here, he doesn't just give resurrection and life to us. No, he is resurrection and life. Therefore, the only way to have resurrection and life is to invite the one who is resurrection and life into our very selves, into our very souls and bodies, by inviting the presence of Christ through his Spirit. See, the reason that physical death could not hold Jesus down is because he is, by nature, resurrection and life. Therefore, death cannot coexist with Jesus. But the good news is the same then is true for us. That when the resurrection and life lives within us, we know that we will never die, as Jesus says here, that physical death will not be able to hold us down, because the Spirit of Jesus, the resurrection and the life, lives within us. So this is a powerful truth and saying that Jesus is talking about here. And of course, what he's referring to ultimately is our salvation. So Jesus has given us a sign. He's backed it up with a saying. But all of this is really about our salvation. So let's look at that here in this last part, verses 38 through 48, and I'll read 38 and then 45 through 48. But verse 38 says, Jesus raising Lazarus from the dead. Jesus, once more deeply moved, came to the tomb. It was a cave with a stone laid across the entrance. Take away the stone, he said. But Lord, said Martha, the sister of the dead man, by this time there's a bad odor, for he has been in there for 4 days. So, you know, here's Lazarus in this tomb, like behind me, for 4 days. Then Jesus said, did I not tell you, if you believe, you will see the glory of God, the sign? So they took away the stone, and then Jesus looked up and said, Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I said this for the benefit of people standing here, that they may believe that you sent me. And Jesus raises Lazarus from the dead, and he comes out. And then it says in verse 45, therefore many of the Jews who had come to visit Mary and had seen what Jesus did, they believed in him. So that's one response. But then there's another response in the verses that follow. It says, but some of them went to the Pharisees and told them what Jesus had done. Then the chief priests and the Pharisees called a meeting of the Sanhedrin. What are we accomplishing? They asked. Here is this man performing many signs. If we let him go on like this, everyone will believe in him. And then the Romans will come and take away both our temple and our nation. So we get two responses here. In verse 45, those who believe in Jesus as they see his sign, as they hear his saying. And this is the whole point of John's gospel. In fact, in chapter 20, verse 31, he says, hey, I am writing these things so that you might believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing, you may have life in his name. So verse 45 represents this whole theme of John. It's meant to bring us into belief in Jesus. But the response in verses 46 through 48 should give us some pause. It's a bit of a sobering response here, that those who witnessed Jesus raising Lazarus from the dead saw the sign, heard the saying, and yet refused to believe. They were more preoccupied with protecting their own interests. They say here in verse 48, if we let him go on like this, everyone will believe in him. They don't want that. And then the Romans will come and take away our temple and our nation. You see how they're worried about Jesus disrupting the world that they know. It's like Thomas talked about last week, that the disruption that Jesus can bring to our sin or our sinful ways of thinking and doing. See, Jesus comes and there's a disruption that takes place when we're faced with the resurrection and the life, and we have to make a decision. Will we believe in him, cast all of these things aside? These leaders here, they're worried about their jobs. They're worried about the economics of what it would mean if we start believing in Jesus. I mean, there's a great upheaval that happens when we place our faith in Christ and we declare him as Lord. So Jesus has revealed his glory through a sign, the raising of Lazarus from the dead, through a saying, I am the resurrection and the life. But then ultimately he reveals his glory through his suffering on the cross. And we have to ask this question, are we going to respond like verse 45 or verse 48? Are we going to believe in Jesus for what we have seen, the sign, the saying that he's done? Or will we harden our hearts and hold on to our own ways of doing things? See, when Jesus went to the cross, it's such an interesting paradox that this moment where the intense hatred of the world for God, where we nailed Jesus to the cross because of our own sin and our own rebellion, in this, the world's most intense moment of hatred for God, is when God chose to show and demonstrate the ultimate sign of how much he loves us. And that should just never cease to amaze us and wow us, that where the world's hatred was at its most intense is when God's love was at its most intense. And this should bring us to our knees in worship and submission and wanting to honor God and saying, Jesus, I'm letting go of everything else and I'm gonna submit my life to you, the resurrection and the life. For all of these things I can hold on to in this world, they're not gonna mean anything someday. All that's gonna matter is, did I live for the resurrection and the life that I have in you? So we're gonna sing this song declaring the beauty of Jesus, the beauty of this suffering servant hanging on the cross. And as we do, really focus in on these lyrics, that I see you there hanging on a tree. You bled and then you died and then you rose again for me. And as you do that, I encourage you to affirm, maybe for the first time, that you want to follow Jesus, the only one who can give you life that is truly life, the only one who can help you conquer physical death because the resurrection lives within you. Or maybe reaffirm your commitment to Jesus and living for him. But allow the Spirit to use this song to speak with you, to engage the heart of God and draw closer to him. And then I'll close us with a scripture reading and a benediction.
See you.
So Jesus gave us a sign, the raising of Lazarus from the dead. He gave us a saying, I am the resurrection and the life. But none of this matters if it doesn't lead us into what he desires for us, salvation, deliverance from sin and from death. So let me leave you with this hopeful, victorious passage about that day when we conquer death forever at the resurrection from 1 Corinthians chapter 15, starting in verse 54. The saying that is written will come true. Death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, he gives us victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, stand firm. So receive this last verse as the benediction. Stand firm, let nothing move you. Always give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. So go forth standing firm in the resurrection and the life, knowing that your labor, therefore, is not in vain. Amen. Have a great day, everyone.